nawafil every day, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build for him qasr fil jannah, a palace in Jannah, subhanallah. Yani, in this dunya, brothers, I don't want to say everyone, all the people, most of the people, they are looking to have their own houses. And if he has a small flat, he's looking for a house. If he has a house there, he's looking for a villa, and maybe a building, or maybe two houses. Maybe he married two wives after that. Or four houses to marry four wives. Okay. So, but here, you can, bi-idhnillah, guarantee house in Jannah by reading or praying these 12 rak'ahs, sunan rawatib, every day. This is the minimum. Can we make more? Of course we can. You can pray four rak'ah after dhuhr. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, if you pray four rak'ah before dhuhr, four rak'ah after dhuhr, hurrima jasaduhu ala nar, that your body will be free from the hellfire. Allahu Akbar. Does it cost me that much? Four rak'ah before dhuhr, four rak'ah after dhuhr. 5 minutes here, 5 minutes here, 5 minutes dhuhr. So in the 20 minutes, bi-idhnillah, I can protect my body from the hellfire, inshallah. You can pray four rak'ah before asr. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith ibn Umar, rahimallahu man salla qabl al-asr arba. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give mercy to the one who pray four rak'ah before asr. You can pray two rak'ah before maghrib, two rak'ah before isha. And you can pray what the scholars, they call it an-nafl al-mutlaq. Nafl al-mutlaq, unlimited. So someone coming here, praying asr in the masjid, or praying dhuhr, and he has nothing between dhuhr and asr, and he said, I'd like to start now praying. Pray 4, 8, 12, 20, 100. This is open. This is nafil mutlaq. And this is not bid'ah. And if you'd like to pray nafil mutlaq at any time, there's no restriction. Where is the problem? If you pray 10 rak'ah today, and you, then tomorrow you say only 10, and then you consider this is part now of the sunnah, now this becomes bid'ah. But when you do it from time to time, and you don't limit it to any number of rak'ah, and you all the time believe this is open, this is nafl mutlaq, there is no problem, inshallah. And all of us, we know, we have the taraweeh in Ramadan. And mashallah, you'll find, I can say, maybe 85% of the people, they come to the taraweeh and they continue. But you'll find the imam will pray the first two rak'ah, then a group or one line will be empty. After the four rak'ah, another line. Six rak'ah, maybe half of the masjid. Alhamdulillah that the imam will finish the witr and there's still one or two lines before him. That's great. Why? Because as I said earlier, there is no azima sadiqa. He doesn't have the passion to do this. He doesn't have the right intention. And he is losing a great reward. You know what the reward? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, if you pray Taraweeh or Qiyam al-Layl with your imam until he finishes, فَكَأَنَّمَا قَامَ اللَّيْلَ كُلَّهِ, it is as he prayed the whole night. Subhanallah. And when you compare, really, and when you think, how many minutes the difference between the one who pray for or the one who continue? Say, 20 minutes. And the people, these days, they spend these 20 minutes and 1 hour in nothing. They sit in front of the TV just to watch the news, half an hour. If we'd like to watch a drama, 1 hour. Film, 2 hours. Football match, how long? 1 hour and a half, is it?
Yes.
1 hour and a half, football match. And you watch a football match, and at the end, if you are supporting one of these teams, you'll be angry if your team will lose. But now, if you come to the masjid and stay one hour and a half in Taraweeh, then when you leave, no, you are a winner. You are not loser. So Taraweeh is a great opportunity because there is a lot of benefits in it. Firstly, you have the reward of praying Salat Taraweeh in itself. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man qama Ramadan imanan wa ihtisaban ghufr lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi." The one who pray Taraweeh Ramadan, imanan, believing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ihtisaban, looking for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will wipe off all his previous sins. This is the first benefit. The second benefit, you are listening to the Quran. And while you are listening, you are rewarded. Thirdly, you are in the masjid. And as long as you are in the masjid, the angels, they are praying for you. As long as you are in the masjid. And it's an opportunity to meet your brothers, to see your brothers. This will make the bond between you and brothers greater. And obviously, this is the same for sisters. And I'll say it again. It is an opportunity to start looking forward to improve your salah by, after Ramadan, you start praying Qiyam al-Layl. Because now you are familiar with standing for 1 hour. You're familiar with that. So after Ramadan, you'll be able to do this, inshallah ta'ala. If you'd like to utilize Ramadan to the maximum limit, inshallah, you need to try to free yourself from the dunya. And for every age, you'll find there is different dunya. So when I was young, ages ago, the dunya for the children would be just go outside and play. This is the dunya. Then the dunya for the children these days and adults is the laptop, the iPad, the phone. This is the dunya. The people now, they are leaving everything for this. And mainly the phones. Because on the phone, you have your Facebook, you have Twitter, you have Instagram, you have this and that and WhatsApp and all of these things. And just to cover all of these things, you need hours. Because if you just WhatsApp your friends or you are part of 10, 15, 20 groups, just to read this, you need hours. And if you'd like to follow the updates in your Facebook, this needs hours. Twitter, anything comes to you, you need to tweet, or there is a subject that the people are tweeting about it, you need to talk about it. Then Instagram, especially girls, they keep saying, photo this, and do it, and then Snapchat, I missed that. So this is the dunya now. And anyone who is saying this doesn't exist, he's cheating himself. Obviously, the people, they are using this in different levels. At the top of this, there's people on games, because many of these games now, you can do it online. So they have it either on laptop or they have this Xbox and a PlayStation 4, and they can play with their cousin in Malaysia, for example, or in Kenya or in Nigeria. Okay, so they are here, but they are still in contact, and with the time difference, so you'll find them until 2 or 3 in the morning, they are playing. Now, if you'd like to utilize Ramadan, you have to keep all these away. Because, very simple fact, and the people sometimes miss this fact. The simple fact, everything on the internet, during all of these things, it's there. So I can read my messages now. I can stop the lecture and pick my phone and start reading my messages. Okay. Now, if I didn't do that, and I read it after midnight, these messages will go. What do you think? They are there. If I have Facebook, And I posted something and I'd like to see if someone made comments. So if I do this now or I do it after Ramadan, it's the same. So you have to remember this. And maybe this idea, this is a proof. Okay. So the idea is, مشاغل الدنيا, these things which will divert you from doing something for the akhirah, stay away from. I mentioned earlier the salah, and I forgot to mention the Quran and the dhikr, subhanallah. Reading Quran, now how can you read Quran if you are busy with all these things? So you have to free yourself from reading Quran, to read Quran, to be able to read Quran. And I'd like you, and this advice to myself also, you remember what I said about Imam Shafi'i? How many times he used to read in Ramadan, if you remember? 60 times. In Ramadan, he will make khatma, how many? 60 times. Okay. Twice a day. One in the morning and one at night. And the one who's narrating this from him, he used to do this in Salah. In Salah. Yani, the gap between us and Imam Shafi'i is big. So we don't want to say, we start to say Imam Shafi'i, let us make it less. And the thing is, you look at most of the people and they think, my target is to complete the Mus'haf, Ramadan. So this means that one juzu, 20 pages a day. And obviously, some might manage to do that, and because of the life, maybe you'll be sick, maybe you have a lot of, you are busy, then you might not finish. Then when it is 27, 28, you say, oh, I'm still in Surat al-Kahf. There's 15 juzu left. I haven't finished. Now I'll give you the plan. The plan is make your target 5 times in Ramadan. That I'd like to do it 5 times. Which means that I need to read about how many juzu. Who can work it quickly? If I'd like to read it 5 times, this means every 6 days I need to finish. Am I right? Yeah. And this means 5 juzu a day. So if I spread this, if I come for Fajr early, then I have half an hour. And I start and stay after Fajr another half an hour, this is 1 hour, I can read 2 juzu if I am a good reader. And Dhuhr time, I can read before and after another juzu. Okay. Asr, sit after Asr 1 hour, you do another 2 juzu. So we finish the 5. Simple, it's not difficult. Now, what is the benefit of making my target high? That if I missed Dhuhr or Asr or Fajr, I'm still managed to do 4 or 3, minimum 2. But I will not that be in a situation that Ramadan has finished and I'm still in Surah Al-Kahf. Or some maybe in Surah Al-Baqarah still. Okay, because they think it is 50 pages, I need to do 1 page a day. And Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, I done my job. No. Brothers, remember, every letter, 10 hasana. You say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, 19. 19 letters. How many hasana? Come on. 190. Tabir Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will multiply it with what? 700 times. 700 times. So just reading Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, I think maybe 14,000 Hasani. Just say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So, and we need this. Because in the Day of Judgment, it is either thakulat muazinuhu or khafat muazinuhu. There isn't any other option. Either your scales heavy or they are what? Light. Thakulat, heavy. Khafat, light. The best way to tathqeel al-muazin, to make your scales heavy, is qira'at al-Qur'an, reading the Qur'an. So, make your intention to do this, that at least I'll do 5 juz a day. Especially these days, the day is very long, yani between Asr and Maghrib, there's 3 hours. If you say, between Asr and Maghrib, I will not spend any minute of these without anything, then, except Quran, you do the 5 juz in these 3 hours, inshallah. And also, I link another thing to Quran. Make an intention to memorize a surah in this month. Surah, 2-3 pages. Tabarak, al-Mulk, al-Qalam, al-Rahman, al-Waqi'ah, Yasin. These surahs, which is most of people, they love it. So, Yasin, I think 6-8 pages. You can do it. Ar-Rahman, 3 pages, 4 pages. Al-Mulk, 2.5 pages. It's not a big thing. But if you spread it on the month, this means that you are doing 1-2 lines, 3 lines a day. And you end up gaining that you memorize the surah. And this surah, like Surah Al-Mulk, will save you from the punishment of the grave. 30 ayahs. Means that if you memorize 1 ayah a day, you finish by memorizing Surah Al-Mulk. On top of that, try to say, I'd like to understand few surahs that I am frequently reading. I'd like to understand what's the meaning of Fatiha? What's the meaning of Surah Al-Ikhlas, Al-Falaq, Al-Nas, Al-Nasr? These surahs that you are reading on a daily basis. Try to understand them. And this will give you more khushu' inshallah in your salah. About the dhikr, try to use the time to make a lot of istighfar, astaghfirullah. The 4 words, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about them. Kalimatan khafifatani ala lisan, thaqilatani fil mizan. Subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim. There is 2 words, they are very light on the tongue and very heavy in the scales. Subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim. And it is good also during Ramadan to learn about ahkam al-siyam, the rules of fasting. I am sure all of us, we know the general rules, but it's good to know some of more details. So, we have, mashallah, here Sahih al-Bukhari. Go to Sahih al-Bukhari and read only the chapter of Siyam. And I assure you, if you go and start reading in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, the chapter of Siyam, you'll find hadiths you never seen in your life. Or, if you read this before, it will remind you of a hadith that you forgot. Because there is a lot of good hadith in this. Make a lot of dua in Ramadan. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لِلصَّائِمِ دَعْوَةٌ لَا تُرَدْ. The one who is fasting has a dua which is guaranteed. It will not be rejected. And one of the best times of making the dua, just before iftar. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us, اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَسْأَلُكَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ الَّتِي وَسَعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَنْ تَغْفِرْ لِي. Very beautiful dua. اللهم إني أسألك برحمتك التي وسعت كل شيء أن تغفر لي. Say this dua at that time and make a lot of dua inshallah تعالى. Finally, I'd like to say, make a plan for your day. that I wake up at 2, have my suhoor, then by 2:30 I'm finished, get ready, come to the masjid, pray Fajr, you pray at 3, and after Fajr, as I mentioned earlier, stay, read at least one juzur. Then you can stay until Shuruq, pray 2 rak'ah, the reward of it, Hajj and Umrah. Then, if you have lectures or you are doing work, alhamdulillah, door time, try to come to the masjid early, so you can read before the salah, read Quran, pray the salah jama'ah, then after that you can continue your work. Asr, if you finished, try to sit and read some Quran. During the day, try to make a lot of good deeds. Give sadaqah, if you can. Talk to your parents, especially when you are away now. So your parents, they miss you. So give them a call. Don't rely on only in these messages, because the message doesn't, it's totally different from the call. The call, they hear you and they will be so happy when they hear your voice. Remember a friend, a brother that you didn't call him for a long time. Give them a call for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or go and visit a brother or a sister for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to attend the gatherings of iftar, because this will strengthen the bond of brothers and sisters. And be sure that you don't miss the taraweeh. Now, between the taraweeh and suhoor, there are some people, they go to sleep, some people, they keep awake. If you are awake, don't waste this time in internet or on TV. Try to use this time, read the Quran and improve your knowledge. This is some advice, I think it might benefit all of us, inshallah, during how to benefit from the month of Ramadan. In the next 10 minutes, inshallah, if there is any questions about this topic or anything related to it, you are welcome. Jazakumullah khair. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik.
One clarification in terms of the notation. We used to know from some of our scholars that intention is best made with acts in the mind. And just as you have rightly says, that if it is voluntary fasting, even if one wake up with that intention of fasting, you can make intention at any point in time if you have not eaten. And for the Ramadan,
you must make it the night.
The beginning. Then if you have met the intention at the beginning of Ramadan, is there any need to make it on daily basis?
Now, there is hadith in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, Bayyutu siyam al-layl, means that make the niyyah of the siyam at night. And this is for Ramadan. And this is the opinion of many scholars, of many madhab. There is, in some madhab, I'm not sure which one now, they are saying that if you say at the beginning of Ramadan, I'm intending to fast the whole month of Ramadan, that's enough. There is no hadith to support this as far as I know. And as I said, you don't need actual words for this. What you need is to make the intention in your mind, in your heart. And I think during what I was talking, I said, when you go to sleep, if you make the niyyah, it's okay. Waking up for sahur is a niyyah in itself, because why you are eating at sahur? The people, they don't wake up and start eating at 2 o'clock in normal times. So the only reason for that is this. So this is just to clarify. Now for the voluntarily, I'm sure you know this. The scholars, they don't make a lot of restrictions on the volunteer leave, like the fard, even in the salah. So you'll find in the salat sunnah, for example, you can stop it. But the salat fard, if you started this, you cannot leave it until you finish. But someone, he started two rak'ah sunnah, and anything happened to him, or he thinks there is no sin in leaving it. In a way, I can say there is a relaxed terms when it comes to volunteer leave, when you compare it with the fard. So this applies also to the voluntarily fasting, because you don't have to make the niyyah the night before. So you can do it during the day if you didn't eat. And also you can break it unless it is you are making it up. So if I was sick in Ramadan, and after Ramadan I am fasting one day to make up the missed day. No, I cannot break my fast one day, that day. I must finish it, unless there's an excuse. But if someone is fasting voluntarily, after time he found himself tired or a little bit hungry, and he say, okay, I still have time to do more days, so let me go and have drink or have some food. There's no harm in this. So the general rule that the scholars saying that the voluntarily action more relaxed in the rules than the fun.
Why I ask this question is, for one who has maybe wake up to take support, it means, just as you have said, he has intention of maybe has qualified his intention for the next fasting. But he has already made his intention to, inshallah, if Allah will, he will observe the complete fasting of the month of Ramadan. And maybe by virtue of circumstance, he could not wake up for the sahur. Maybe he's left up until the Fajr. He wake up. He has to continue.
This is what I am saying.
The intention is already there.
Yeah, I am saying that when you go to sleep, you make the intention. When you go to sleep, you make the intention. Inshallah. And this will make it easy. And it's not something difficult. Yeah.
Inshallah. Next, my question is about another salah after Witr. Because before Tarawih finish, we always do Witr, and some of opinions say there is no another Salah after Witr. So sometimes it is make me hesitant when I have planned to do Tahajjud before Sahur. What is this?
Now, in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what is his Sunnah in the Qiyam, which is Hadith Aisha, that he used to pray only 11 rak'ah. But it is narrated that he used to pray 2 rak'ah after Witr. Now some scholars, they said this 2 rak'ah is Sunnah al-Fajr. Because what was the practice of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? He used to pray Qiyam al-Layl until Fajr. So when it is Fajr time, or the Fajr is coming, he will make 1 Witr. Then after that, he will pray the sunnah. So some scholars, they say these 2 rak'ah actually sunnah al-fajr. Other scholars, they said, no, it's okay, there's no harm in praying 2 rak'ah after the witr. But you cannot pray 2 witr in the same night. So if you prayed 1 witr, with the imam here, when you go home, pray 2 rak'ah, for example, you can make it them long, and you don't do another route. So, and you see in the haram, for example, in the last 10 days, they are making this tahajjud that they will pray the 20 rak'ah, because there are two opinions of, is it 8 or 20, And I am following the opinion of eight, but I don't make a big problem with those people who say that I'd like to make to pray 20. And the fact is, and I noticed this yesterday, in our Masjid in Luton, we pray 8 rak'ah. Okay? And we start at the same time with the other Masjid. Yani both of us start at the same time. And the Masjid, just maybe 500 yards from us, they pray 20. So we finished Salat Tarawih, and I was passing there, and they are coming at the same time. So they're praying 20 rak'ah, but very fast. And in many masjids, they pray 8 rak'ah quietly. And believe me, brothers, yani, I've seen some of those people who are praying the 20. And it has nothing to do with salah. Put it like this. Nothing to do with salah. I cannot forget an imam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him. The proper imam wasn't there, and he lit the jama'ah, and he prayed Surah Al-Kahf. I am Arab, and I cannot follow him in reading Surah Al-Kahf.
So fast.
Yeah. What's the point? No. Yani, this is not the sunnah. This is nothing to do with the recitation. Yeah, recitation, you read in a clear way. The people who are behind you, if they know Arabic, they understand what you are saying. If they know half Arabic, they can catch half. Those who doesn't know, at least they can see that you are saying something makes sense to them because they read the Quran. Because when you read the Quran many, many times, even if you don't understand Arabic, after that, the Quran in itself, when you hear it, it makes sense to you because you said, I read this before. It is in your memory somewhere. But if someone comes and read, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Rahman, Rahim, Maliki, Yawmiddin, it's what you are thinking. This has happened. So you can pray 2 rak'ahs after. And some they say you can pray more. But my opinion is you can pray 2 rak'ahs and make them long. And then the reward is there, inshallah. Another question? Okay. JazakumAllah khair. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.